Very interesting. What about just the whole concept of daily Kaizen, where I guess oftentimes leaders think that the lean is something that someone else should do, like they're above and beyond that, and it needs to be outsourced or maybe the group of lean leaders inside organization does do all the work with lean, and then the executive feel that it's not part of their job to either embrace or coach or teach anything to do with lean. So, how do you change that? Like, what should they do?
That is obviously alien to what I'm talking about, and it's alien to the turtle way. Within Toyota, they, even though it's not top-down in the same sense as we're used to in the West, the leaders are teachers. They also are very demanding teachers, and they expect responsibility and accountability. So if you're in the leadership chain, you run a department, you run a plant, you run a call center, whatever you run, you're responsible not only for running it and making sure that the work gets done, but you're also responsible for improving it. And you have clear improvement objectives, and you have to have the skills to move the team toward those objectives through Kaizen. So you can, that's what we want to get to. Now, to get there, you have to start someplace, and generally in the early stages, the role of the expert lean coach is more critical to get you started, to get the positive examples that people can see and learn from and see what's possible. And then a good consultant or a good lean trainer will transition from to being more directive in the early stages to beginning to hand over to the people the steering wheel and guide them. So they might work on the next big project that might take longer, it might be rougher, it might be cruder, but you have to teach somebody to a skill like riding a bike, they have to get on the bike, and they might have to fall down a few times. So that's the next stage, and that could be actively led by the top if they're enlightened, or it could be run by the middle of the organization. Then when you get some successes, then you can start pushing upward, and then the top needs to get a coach. The idea that we hire the experts, the idea that we delegate this makes it's the way we think about organizations traditionally, and it's not too bad if that's the starting point. It becomes bad if that's the ending point, if you never get to the point where the core of your leadership from top to bottom is accountable for aggressive improvement targets and also has lear have learned a good method for developing people, for doing Kaizen to get to reach those improvement targets. That has to happen. It could start from the side with experts, and they could be working at the bottom with middle managers. It could start from different parts of the organization. The question is, does it keep evolving, and do the experts turn over hand the keys at some point to the operating managers, so they're taking over? But the idea, I think there's a misconception sometimes that the ultimate in Kaizen is the work group and the team member doing Kaizen. So if we can drive down to a daily management system with visual boards, that's ideal, so let's just focus there. But a person doing work is going to make improvements only within their very narrow domain of work, whereas the leaders at each level have to make improvements at their level. It might be at the department level, it might be at the cross-department level. At the top, it might be across companies with your suppliers and your dealers. So in Toyota, every level of management is accountable for Kaizen and specific targets, and they're responsible for something that's broad enough for their level. And the biggest changes that make the biggest impact are led by senior management.
Hmm, I see. Well, there's a lot of things to take in today, Dr. Leiker. Another maybe trend that's that we're seeing at here at Lean Sensei is that more and more companies that are non-manufacturing are embracing Lean. That's whether it's hospitals or financial sectors or insurance companies. So what's your thoughts on that? Because some people say, hey, Lean is really more about manufacturing or operational company and not so much for transactional service-oriented companies.
Say that is because that's where it started, and it's where where it's gotten the most publicity, and it's also where you can visibly see it very clearly. So when you take a manufacturing plant and you have specialized departments with different machines, like here's the machining department, here's the stamping department, here's the welding department, here's the assembly department, they're all physically separated, and then you lay that out into a flow line, so you have parts one piece flow going through those steps, it's a dramatic difference. It's a visual difference. The results are often very, very fast and clear in productivity and quality and lead time and lowered inventory. So you get these big bangs that you can physically see. Now let's take, for example, an organization, whether it's a hospital or an insurance company, or and you have different departments, and each department has specialists. But, for example, in a hospital, the customers cross over many different departments as they enter the hospital and get treated and leave the hospital and get post-hospital care. And they're cutting across all these different departments. And those departments are kind of like the machines. One's like a stamping press, one's like a welding machine. In the traditional system, they don't talk to each other, they don't communicate, and the handoff of the patient is very bad, and there's a lot of waste, and the patient has to wait, and errors are made. So now you have to think about flow. What does one-piece flow mean from the point of view of the patient moving across departments, across steps, just like you're thinking about the part moving one-piece flow across steps? And conceptually, it becomes almost the same thing you're doing in the manufacturing plant, but it's more difficult to see because you're not physically moving the people in a line where they handle the patient. Sometimes, you know, very often in lean surfaces, we will end up changing the layout, perhaps to a more open office, and perhaps you have a group of people who are handling all the transactions for a certain group of patients, and they have daily meetings, and it can look pretty similar to the factory. But in other cases, people stay in their home departments, and you have to watch how they communicate and a longer-term process. It's not seconds. It's hours and days and weeks. So it's hard to see, and therefore it's a little harder to visualize. When you do visualize it, and often that happens when a group of people use value stream mapping to map, say, the way the patient proceeds or the way item proceeds, let's say an insurance transaction proceeds to the system, and you then look at that, and all the people who are involved from different departments see the current state, and they see an enormous amount of waste, and then they together develop a future state, which provides a vision for where we want to get to, and they have some metrics as targets. They'll work their way to that future state, just as you would in manufacturing. And the results will be clear and measurable, even though the process is a bit less visible. So it's kind of a mind frame, and you're still trying to achieve one-piece flow as an ideal. You're still trying to satisfy customers with what they need and the amount they need at the right time, and you still have to have a product or a service that appeals to the customers and gives them more than they even realize that they need. So, again, at a 10,000-foot level, the concept is virtually identical. But when you get down into the weeds in manufacturing, it looks much more clear and standard and visible than in a lot of service processes.
Mm. But the bottom line is it doesn't really make difference what the organization produces.
Somebody, for example, somebody who's well-trained in lean in manufacturing will and is really well-trained, and they don't think twice about applying lean to a service process. To them, it will look just the same as the manufacturing process. They have they have not only the tools, but the principles ingrained in their minds, and they can apply those equally well. In fact, in Toyota Motor Sales was much later to adopt lean methods than the manufacturing side of Toyota. And Toyota Motor Sales has service parts operations that distribute parts to dealers, and the service parts operations are very advanced with the Toyota production system. And it's a physical product that's moving, so it's very much like material handling in a Toyota factory. Those people who came out of the warehouses, the service parts operations, turned out to be some of the best teachers for the service operations, say finance, within Toyota Motor Sales, because they had the experience with the physical side, and they'd learned enough that they were able to apply the principles that they had used to service operations, whereas the people coming out of service operations often were kind of blind because they'd grown up in it. They're blind to what's possible and how they could change it.
Okay, well, thank you so much for your amazing insights. We're going to shift the gear a little bit and maybe just talk a little bit about the Lean Summit that's coming up in June. Maybe you could just comment a little bit about the history of the Lean Summit with Lean Sensei and what this conference is all about.
Well, the one that I was personally involved in, two of my co-authors were also there, David Meyer, who wrote the Toyota Way Field book, and Mike Ozeas, who wrote Toyota Culture with me. They both came out of Toyota and were authors, and the experience, and there were also some industrial people, and the industrial people were in the companies that I mentioned that get it, that understand the people side and the culture side. So there was a very strong consistency of message that really focused on the deep change that has to happen in people, in leadership, in culture. And that's what will also be true in this next session. I'll be talking about lean leadership, which I know a lot more about because I wrote a book on it compared to when I was there last time, and I think you'll see that all the company speakers as well will have become more mature and have a deeper understanding. So I think it'll be similar to what I experienced, but it'll be deeper, and particularly deeper on understanding how you change an organization, how you change people, how you change the way they think and the way they behave.
Right, I'm still remember having a conversation with you, I guess, almost 5 years ago when I first called you, Dr. Leiker, and suggested that you and David Meyer and Michael Zayas come to the conference.